Hi, my name is Skylar Church. I am a California real estate broker as well as a member of the education department at accredited real estate schools. We offer the course requirements to be eligible to take that state exam in California, but also to make sure you're prepared. And all we do is focus in California for this real estate exam. That is what we've been doing since 1995. We don't do any of the other states. We don't do any of the other career license exams. So we just specialize and focus in California. And because all we do is California, that will help you if you decide to go with us to make sure you're not learning material that's not needed for the California real estate exam. This is all we do, we specialize in, and we're really good at it, truthfully. So if you want to learn a little bit more about some practice questions, keep watching, but also make sure to like and subscribe as well as comment below so we keep producing new content. And also check out the link below with other exam preparation options that we offer. So let's get to it. Question number one, determining the value of a single family residence. The appraiser would primarily use the A, cost approach, B, comparison approach, C, income approach, D, land residual technique. So as always, I like to say, let's dissect the question, figure out what it's asking, and kind of formulate an answer without really even going through the answer options. So we're looking at determining the value of a single family residence. So there, single family residence is the key portion or the key element to this question of what an appraiser would primarily use. So what type of approach would an appraiser use when valuing a single family residence? Well, what three approaches are the main ones? We have the cost approach, the income approach, but then the most important one is the market data approach, which is also called the comparison approach. Now, what do we know about these three approaches? The cost approach, this is used for like special use buildings, like for instance, like an old firehouse, an old library, properties that are hard to value because they're not readily comparable to other properties. The income approach, that's used on income producing properties. So usually like multi-unit properties, commercial, etc., properties that derive income. And then we have the comparison approach, which is the market data approach. This is the most readily usable approach because you use sales comparables. And the sales comparables are a really great tool to help with making adjustments and figuring out what the market, where the market currently is at. And so single family homes usually use sales comparables by using the market data approach. That is the primary use for it. And so the appraiser would primarily use the market data approach, so which is called the comparison approach. So that is the best answer there going through it. Wouldn't be cost approach. That would be if it was like a special use building. Income approach, if it was an income producing property, then the appraiser would primarily use the income approach. And the land residual technique, that actually falls within the income approach and is something that is very, very special. It's misunderstood and it's not something you need to know about for the real estate exam. It's very, very complex. And if you see that on any of your questions or anything like that, I will tell you it's going to be a wrong answer. What we only need to look at and know about are the three main approaches of the cost approach, income approach, and then the most important one, the market data approach, which is called the comparison approach. And we use sales comparables within that approach. And sales comparables are really, there's an abundance of them for single family homes. And that's why the market data approach is the best approach. And the appraiser would primarily use that approach when valuing a single family residence. So that's the correct answer. And let's move on to question number two. If a buyer purchases a real property where he'll take title subject to the seller's existing loan on the property and the sale is made without the knowledge or consent of the lender, it should be disclosed to both buyer and seller that A, the lender may accelerate the loan if he finds out about it, B, the sale may not be completed if the lender calls the loan due and the buyer cannot find other financing, C, the seller remains personally liable for the loan and any potential deficiencies. D, all of the above are correct. So the first thing we have to do is look at the question, figure out what they're asking and what they're wanting out of it. So a buyer purchases a real property where he will take title subject to the seller's existing loan on the property. Now you need to know here that subject to is a term. This is a term you need to know about because otherwise you might just be thinking of a regular loan assumption. But no, this is a subject to loan. And what do we know about subject to loans? Well, it's relatively complicated. There's a lot to it. And you honestly won't see them really in the real world. They don't happen as much. They really stopped about 87 was really when they stopped. But you need to know about them for the state exam because it's an illogical concept. And because of that, of course, the DRE is going to ask you questions on it. And that's why we're talking about it today. Now note, I'm gonna be going at this at a very cursory level. There's a lot to know about subject to loans. It gets very complex, but we're just gonna be talking about it on what you need to know about for the state exam to be able to help you answer these questions, okay? So very cursory level, what you really need to know about, but no, there's a lot more to it. So we're now talking about subject to, and it's a subject to loan because the sale is made without the knowledge or consent of the lender. Now, what needs to be disclosed to both the buyer and seller when a subject to loan is going to be happening? Well, let's look at the first answer option. The lender may accelerate the loan if he finds out about it. Definitely. So as you know, there is an acceleration clause, and within that acceleration clause, a loan becomes due and payable upon a happening of a certain event. A lot of the times, it's alienation due on sale when the property is conveyed. And on this case, if you are doing a subject to loan, a buyer is purchasing the property and going to be basically taking over the loan, but without the knowledge and consent of the lender. So it's happening subject to. If the lender finds out about this, the lender could accelerate the loan due and payable because this event did happen. Now, so that is something that the buyer and seller need to know about. What about the sale may not be completed if the lender calls the loan due and the buyer cannot find other financing? They're basically saying, hey, before the property actually even is sold and the subject to happens, the lender could find out about it and make the loan due. And so the buyer would then have to find other financing. And if they can't find other financing, then the sale will not be able to happen. Then the buyer could lose, you know, any money that was been invested on inspections, for instance. So that's why it's important for the buyer to be aware of it, that, hey, the lender could find out about it and this won't even happen. So the sale wouldn't even happen before a subject to loan actually occurs to be able to buy the property. So you need to know about that. That's definitely something that could happen. And now what about the seller remains personally liable for the loan and any potential deficiencies? Yes, because remember, the biggest thing that you need to know about subject to loans is that the seller remains personally liable for the loan and also any potential deficiencies that could happen. So for instance, if a default of payment happens, then the seller could remain personally liable for those deficiencies. So these are all correct about subject to loans. So the best answer is all of the above are correct. And this is because it's subject to. Now, when you're looking at this question, you may be thinking, hey, subject to the seller's existing loan, just thinking that it's something that, you know, a loan assumption, not really knowing that subject to is a term and you need to know about this term for state exam purposes. Now, you probably won't ever come across this once you're actually licensed because they really stopped happening because they are more prevalent with FHA loans until about 87 when the due on sale clause really became a thing. So really important to know about that. So all of the above are correct when it comes to the subject to loan. So let's move on. 3, the County Board of Supervisors sets the A, county property tax rate, B, assessed value of all properties located in a particular county in California, C, documentary transfer tax for California, D, appraised value of properties located in their county. Well, we're looking at a county level. So, and what the Board of Supervisors does, or a different entity that is comparable to the Board of Supervisors, what do they do? Well, the County Board of Supervisors, they set the property tax rate within their county. So knowing that, looking at this, the best answer looks to be A, the county property tax rate. But let's make sure the other ones are not correct. So the assessed value of all properties located in a particular county in California, the tax assessor within the county is the one that actually sets the assessed value of all the properties. Because remember, when the property is sold, the property is assessed ad valorem, which is according to value. A lot of times it's actually the sale price, but sometimes if the buyer got a screaming deal and it's not really at market value, then it could be assessed at a different number than what it actually sold for. But when it's sold, that is usually when the properties will be reassessed, and reassessed according to value. And remember, because of Prop 13 right now that's still in effect, we're then limited at an increase every year in the assessed value. Right now it's limited to a 2% increase. And so that way some people that have owned their properties for 30, 40 years might have extremely low tax assessments. And that is something that takes into consideration. So just need to know the tax assessor, they're the ones that actually set the assessed value. And then the documentary transfer tax for California is set at the state level by California. And so remember, that's the 55 cents per $500 of new money in the transaction that is needs to be paid. And then what about appraised value of properties located in their county? Nope, appraisers just set the appraised value of the property, and that has nothing to do with the actual tax, what is paid for taxes. Now, the appraised value could assist, though, when the amount that is approved for a loan and when the property is sold, so what it actually sold for, and then that could then come into consideration, reflect in the assessed value sometimes if the tax assessor believes that to be the market value or according to value ad valorem at that time. But the County Board of Supervisors, or whichever entity within that county that is comparable to the Board of Supervisors, sets the county property tax rate. So that is the correct answer. So they take the assessed value set by the county tax assessor, and then the property tax rate for that county set by the County Board of Supervisors. They multiply it, and that is the amount paid in the property taxes each year by that property. So a little bit that you need to know about taxes. And there's a lot more to know about it too, but this is just something that you need to know. From the County Board of Supervisors, they set the county property tax rate. That rate, and that is multiplied then by the assessed value that's set by the tax assessor within the county. 4, brownfields are A, a formal commercial industrial site that is affected by environmental contamination, B, earthquake fault lines, C, non-riparian property owners, D, radon-infused soil. So brownfields. You can kind of infer what it is just based off of the name. It's a field that is brown. Why is it brown? Well, it is a site that has been affected by environmental contamination. So a formal commercial or industrial site that has been contaminated. And that is the best answer for it. It does not deal with earthquake fault lines. It does not deal with non-riparian property owners, nor does it deal with radon-infused soil. Brown fields are fields that are brown because they have been contaminated. And so they've been a formal commercial industrial site that is affected by environmental contamination. That is the best answer. 5. Under an exclusive agency agreement, A, an owner must pay a commission to the broker no matter who sells the property. B, an owner can sell the property to anyone the day after the listing expires with no liability to the broker for commission. C, an owner may sell the property himself without liability for a commission to the broker. D, an owner can subsequently give another broker a listing at any time, which would have the effect of canceling the original listing agreement. So we're talking about an exclusive agency listing agreement. Now, this is one that you need to know about for the all the different types of listing agreements that are out there. Remember, we have the exclusive authorization right to sell. We have an exclusive agency. We have an open listing. We have a net listing. We got pocket listings, oral listings. We got all these types of listings. You need to know them and what they do. And because this question, they're asking about an exclusive agency. Now, an exclusive agency listing agreement is one that you have to pay out a commission to the agent no matter what, unless you yourself as the owner sells the property. That is the only exception to not paying the commission to your agent when it comes to an exclusive agency agreement if they've fulfilled all the other terms. So let's see which of them would be the best answer. So an owner must pay commission to the broker, okay, yes, no matter who sells the property. No, because there is an exception where the owner themselves can sell the property and not pay a commission. So what they're talking about here is an actual exclusive authorization and right to sell. That's not an exclusive agency listing agreement. So A is not correct. B, an owner can sell the property to anyone the day after the listing expires with no liability to the broker for commission. So this is this could be true for any type of agreement as long as the broker protection clause is not in there. That could be the owner can sell the property to anyone with no liability to the broker for commission. Not necessarily saying which agreement this is because that's not really exactly the best explanation of an exclusive agency agreement. C, an owner may sell the property himself without liability for a commission to the broker. Yeah, that's what I basically, you know, what we were talking about. The owner can sell the property themselves without liability to pay the commission to the broker under an exclusive agency agreement. That is true. So that looks to be the best answer, but let's make sure about D. An owner can subsequently give another broker a listing at any time, which would have the effect of canceling the original listing agreement. No, that doesn't deal with an exclusive agency. You can't give another broker a listing at any time in an exclusive agency. In an open listing, you can, but that then wouldn't negate, though, the effect of canceling the original listing agreement for an open listing, for instance. But exclusive agency, the best answer is C. An owner may sell the property himself without liability for commission to the broker. That is the best explanation of it. And I do want to clarify also on answer option B. So they're basically saying here that the owner can sell the property to anyone the day after the listing expires. So when a listing expires, the homeowner is then able to go sign a new listing agreement with a different agent. They're able to sell the property themselves on pretty much any type of listing agreement, not necessarily just an exclusive agency, unless there is that broker protection clause that says, hey, these are the people I've showed the property to within my listing during the active listing that I held. And so I'm going to be entitled to a commission if that buyer purchases the property within a set period of time after the expiration of the listing. So, but that's not just for exclusive agency. So let's then go through these listing agreements just to verify so you have an idea of it. But the best answer for this for an exclusive agency is C. So types of listing agreements. So we have quite a few to choose from. We have an open listing agreement. So this one is a one where multiple brokers can work simultaneously to sell the property. But the commission is only paid to the broker who is the procuring cause of the sale. So the one who actually brings the ready, willing, and able buyer, that is the one that is that would be paid a commission, even though there could be multiple brokers working to sell the property. So there can be multiple open listing agreements to multiple agents. Exclusive authorization right to sell. This is the best listing agreement. This is the one that you'll usually be using when practicing because you get paid a commission no matter what who sells the property. So you are entitled to commission no matter who sells the property within the terms, though, of an active listing agreement of your exclusive authorization and right to sell. And remember, there has to be a definite termination date to that agreement. Now, exclusive agency listing. This is where, what we've been talking about, you get paid a commission no matter who sells the property, except though if the seller sells the property him or herself. That is the exception to it. So it's a pretty good, listing agreement, but it's not as good as the exclusive authorization and right to sell. Then we have a net listing. The best way is we just give you an example of it, where the seller says, hey, I want $200,000 for my property. You can keep anything above that. So if the agent sells the property for $225,000, the agent will receive a $25,000 commission. This is legal in California, but the downside is you could do everything correctly and still not receive a commission, because if it sells for below $200,000, you don't get anything. So that's a net listing. Then we have an option listing, where an agent lists a property for sale, and at the same time, the agent personally has an option to purchase the property for a specified purchase price and length of time to exercise the option. So the agent is selling the property, is representing you, but they also have the ability to purchase the property for a specified purchase price that's already been agreed upon, and the length of time then to actually exercise that option. Now, an oral listing, this is the worst one, because an agent relationship is created by oral agreement and is effective in establishing the relationship, but it's really hard to enforce in a court of law. So really not a good one to do. And so you want to have it in writing for a listing agreement. So that is it for this video. I know we covered a lot of topics. I hope it was helpful in your licensing journey. And if you liked it, make sure to check out our website or contact us. We have a lot of exam preparation, as well as the courses to be eligible to take the state exam and be prepared for it. So I have the link below. And also comment if you have questions, or what you might have, what else you want us to talk about. We are listening to you, and the more involved you are with our channel, the more we'll keep producing material. But feel free to contact us, and we'd be glad to assist you. My name is Skylar Church. I am accredited with the Education Department, as well as a broker. I hope this was helpful, and thanks for watching, and good luck with your licensing journey.